Silent Night, all four verses.
Tender and mild. Beautiful song to start us out with this morning. You can be seated. Thank you for coming out to True Gospel Baptist Church today. Looking forward to what the Lord has for us here in the next few moments through song and through testimony and through most of all the preaching of God's Word. We're going to be in 1 John chapter number 1 today for the day's message. And of course, I started last Sunday a four-part series on Sunday mornings that'll get us right up to Christmas Eve. And I've titled these messages, The Best Gifts for Christmas. And of course, last week we dealt with the gift of light. This morning we're going to be dealing with the gift of life. And we're going to be in 1 John chapter number 1 today. I hope you'll follow along, take notes along with us today. And do want to encourage, if you can, to be here, be faithful in our services. Looking forward to some singing this morning. The choir will be singing a couple of songs, and then the Ziegler family will be singing. Those of you that have children that goes down for the small children's church, which will be the 3 to 6-year-olds. If you'll keep them in here until after the Ziegler family finishes singing, would be good. And but the older group, the 7 to 11-year-olds, once the choir breaks, they can head on back towards the doors there. I do want to mention, as I did last week, if you have kids that go to our children's church ministry, especially over here, be sure to go over there to pick those kids up at the end of the services. It's too many cars, and sometimes they don't dismiss the same time we do. And I would rather you go over there to pick up your children. Just don't forget your children, okay? And but we're glad you're here today. We're going to keep service moving along. I do want to encourage, if you can today, to be in prayer for a couple, more urgent prayer requests. I do ask, if you would, be in prayer for Stephanie. Stephanie woke up this morning, was getting ready to come to church, and just rare, every now and then, she gets these severe headaches that we've dealt with for many, many years with her health. And this morning just happened to be one of those mornings, and she had to lay back down, was getting very dizzy. So if you would, remember her in prayer today. I just checked on her a few moments ago, but if you would, pray for her. And then pray for Bonnie Griffin coming up this Wednesday at 1 o'clock. She's going for a heart catheterization and to check the pressure on her lungs. Of course, Brother Jeff Richardson, very faithful to our church, hasn't been here the last few weeks due to knee operation. Pray for him. Pray for Connie Duggan, Sue Bullens. And then, of course, we want to continue to pray for Sister Doris Moore. Diane, I'm glad you're able to be here today. Glad you're...
She goes this Friday, or the doctor's appointment. Hopefully she can make it this time.
Amen. Let's pray for Sister Doris for that. I'm glad you're able to be back with us this morning. And Dolores, glad you're able to be here this morning as well. Amen. And continue to pray for Brother Todd back here. Brother Todd mentioned to the church Wednesday night. And, of course, maybe, I don't know if you told Sunday school class or not, but Brother Todd was battling cancer a couple years ago, about 2.5 years ago, and some of his tests this past Monday that come back, the cancer itself has come back. But we're trusting in a God that's bigger than cancer, and we're trusting in a God that's bigger than any problem that'll come our way, and Brother Todd is trusting by faith as well. And so you pray for these folks and lift them up to the Lord. Do you want to be in prayer for the Butcher family? Brother Jesse and Dee and their kids will be here tonight. They're going to be singing for us in the service. I would encourage you, if you can, I know it's rainy outside. Look, I won't raise my hand, but I guarantee you my flesh is like your flesh. A day like today is one of those days where the bed's just more comfortable. The pillow is just a little bit softer, and the sleep gets a little deeper, okay? And it's easy to go home this afternoon, take a little nap, and just sleep on in to about 9:30 tonight. Then you up half the night counting sheep everywhere they turn. Come on back tonight if you can. The Butcher family will be a blessing. I've known these people. How many of you know Brother Jesse Butcher and Dee and their kids? Look, these folks are real. They love the Lord. I used to have them at my previous church singing, and Brother Jesse's going to preach for us tonight. So it'll be a good service, a good time of fellowship. I do want to say before we pray, hey, we had a good soup supper last night over here for our Christmas dinner at the church. And those of you that were not able to come, you just missed out on it. I'm telling you, it was all kinds of soups there last night. Good fellowship together. Now, the little games got to play. And I'm going to tell you, you can test Baptists real quick when it comes to playing games. Oh, my soul, we're passing around a box. And it just, man, I'd go over and have a prayer meeting in the morning. Because, you know, I was like second, third one out. Anytime you're playing a game and you're in between two of your sisters and neither one of them can hold a plate at lunchtime, you know you're in trouble when you're passing it around, okay? And so I just went ahead and took an early exit. I said preaching's too important on Sunday to worry about what's in this box. Amen. But we had a good time last night. And, hey, look, our church, our Christian school, everything that had a part yesterday in the Christmas parade in Madison Med-Ann, man, that went real well. Weather wasn't what the weatherman said it would be, wasn't what we thought it would be. But you know what? Hey, the Word of God got out. I think in all between bags we'd bagged up and gospel literature we handed out, probably about 1,700 pieces of literature yesterday went out from this church. And very grateful for the school kids that had part in the float, those that built the float. If you get a chance, go on our Facebook page and look at a lot of those pictures. We were very well represented with the gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ yesterday in the parade, okay? I was walking behind our last float, and these guys kept coming up on those little boards where they got wheels, and they're just rolling all over the place. And I thought, if these guys don't get out of my way, I'm going to stick my leg out here in a minute. But I didn't. And then I got to fellowship and got behind, and I had to outrun those guys. Amen there. But, again, thanks for everybody that had a part in that yesterday. All kidding aside, look, the Word of God's so important every day of our life, especially this time of year. And I'm very grateful for our church. Appreciate Brother Greg and all his campaign managers yesterday for county commissioner. They were in front of us as yesterday as well. And, look, friend, the parades are a great time to get out and enjoy time with your family, but it's also a wonderful, wonderful time to let people know the real meaning behind this time of year. Amen? Let's seek the Lord in prayer today. After we pray, a choir is going to sing for us, and then after the choir breaks, the older children's church group can head on out. But let's go to the Lord in prayer. Brother Todd, if you don't mind, I handed him the microphone back there. Guys, if you would you open us up in prayer?
Let's go to the Lord in prayer. Gracious Heavenly Father, we do approach thy throne of grace. Once again this morning, just thank you for this day.
Yes.
May we be continue to rejoice and be glad in it. The days you've given us. Another day of life. God, sometimes we get in places in our lives where we take each day for granted.
That's right.
Not
Amen.
To do so.
Amen.
God, I pray for our pastor. To break the bread of life this morning.
Anoint yes, help
him.
Us.
Give him that fresh oil as only you can. Thank you for our dear pastor, Lord. Continue to bless us.
Help us,
body,
Lord.
Soul, and
use us.
God, you've heard the spoken request. I just pray, God, you intervene. Thank you for the prayers of the saints in my life and those we bring to you. Facing tests, different surgeries, different maladies, different afflictions. God, I attempted to teach this morning. God, help us to realize we strive to have that fellowship with you
Amen.
In our sufferings.
Amen.
And also to know you and you crucified this morning. I do pray, God, once again, for those tracts were passed out yesterday. I prayed in Sunday school and illustrated, I just pray, God, that your spirit would jump off those pages as these people open it up.
Yes.
And God, if just one person sees you, sees the need of a Savior through
Amen.
That track ministry
Amen.
Yesterday, it'd be worth it all. God, I do pray this morning, if there's one lost in this our midst this morning, Holy Spirit of God, fall upon this place.
Amen.
Convict that heart. Help them to see the goodness of God will lead them to repentance. May today be the day of salvation in someone's heart.
Yes.
In someone's life. God, help us forever look unto you, the author and finisher of faith in all we do. Help us to trust you.
Amen. Amen.
When it's hard to trust you.
That's right.
God, I've been praying much in the past 10 days to 2 weeks, God. I believe. We all believe, God. Help us those times where
Amen.
Help our unbelief. God, we know you're real. Show yourself real this morning through the preaching of thy word. And help us realize, God, it's not all, you're not always in the wind and not always in the fire. Oh, but God, when that still small voice speaks to us, help us be obedient and submissive to what the Spirit's wanting to speak to us today about. Save that soul that's nearest to hell. Rekindle the fire in my heart, the hearts of your people. May we forever praise you and thank you for it. It's in Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
Amen. Thank you, brother. You give a listen to the choir today. Let's worship the Lord. right. Let's all stand while the choir is making their way down. Turn around and tell someone hello right there near you at least. Amen. Saving my life. Amen. Right, you can be seated. You should have met at least 10 new people and got a Christmas list from 5 of them. Amen. Hey, while you're making your way back to your seats this morning, visitors, thank you for coming. If you're a first-time visitor here in a moment, our ushers will come by. You should have hopefully got a visitor card. Fill that out and drop that in when the guys come by here in a moment. We would greatly, greatly appreciate that. If you would, remember the Hill family in prayer as well, Brother Danny Ray and their family. Several of them not feeling well this week, and continue to pray for Sister Leanne as well. She's been battling this upper respiratory stuff, and Sharon still has as well. It's just a lot of that type of stuff going around. It's that time of year for it, but remember these ladies in prayer and lift them up to the Lord, okay? And I believe the Ziegler family is going to come sing for us at this time. After they sing, we'll have our ushers to come. We'll receive our offering. And then I believe Sister Wanda is going to be singing for the offering today. And again, in the message, we'll be in 1 John chapter number 1 today. You give a listen to the Ziegler family.
Well, I'm glad I'm saved this morning. Thank God for a Savior that came in the form of a babe. To be our Lord and Savior.
Amen.
If it wasn't for him, where would we be? Y'all pray for us this morning. I'm glad that we're able to sing. Hopefully Emily will get well enough here before long. She can get back up here with us. But y'all just pray for us.
Come bow before this altar.
you know that your baby boy would one day walk on water? Mary, did you know that your baby boy would save our sons and daughters? Did you know that your baby boy has come to make you new? This child that you delivered will soon deliver you. Mary, did you know that your baby boy will give sight to
Amen. 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 Thank you. Amen. I love you too. Amen. Yeah. Amen. Amen, Todd. Amen. Good testimony. Anybody else real quick? I appreciate Brother Todd and everything he does around this church and ministry. And he's jumped in here recently. And despite the battle he's having right now, he's jumped in and been a big help with us at the Christian school, just helping us teach two classes that was much needed help in. And I appreciate you, brother. Appreciate you standing up bragging on the Lord this week. A lot of times when you get bad news, it's easy to develop the woe is me mentality and want everybody feels sorry for me and I get down the dumps and get down the blues, I'm going to tell you, it's better to keep marching on and moving on for the Lord and truly being grateful in my heart for where I'm at with God and what He's brought me through. Look, I wished I could put you a picture on the wall in here of when Jesus said, "Great is thy reward in heaven." Those are the rewards that we can't put a picture on. I wished I could show you what everything looks like this morning. But I can tell you, according to the Word of God, there's a real place called heaven.
Amen.
Amen. Just as sure as you're in a real place called Madison, in a real church called True Gospel Baptist Church, there's a real heaven one day. And those of us that are saved and born again and know it, we're going there. We're either going by the way of the grave. I buried my uncle on Friday. And you know what? When you get 80-some years old, and you've lived 10 years beyond the average life, a lot of the people you grew up with, a lot of people you know, they done gone on theirself. Every day's precious. Every day you have an opportunity to make an impact. Every day you have an opportunity to be a stepping stone, but you also have an opportunity to be a stumbling block. Just make up your mind, I'm going to be a stepping stone. In the days that I'm a stumbling block, I'm going to ask forgiveness from God and forgiveness from people. And I'm going to be an encourager, not a discourager. The world's got everything it can to throw at you every day to discourage you in your heart. Church is the last place I want to come get discouraged. If we can't come to church and get encouraged, where can we go? Understand that. Where can we go? Now look, if I come in here and I hadn't been living right, I might leave here a little discouraged, but I don't want to be the one to discourage you. Okay, but truth sometimes will rub your cat the wrong way. Amen? But truth's truth. Sometimes, as I told my Sunday school class, God will hurt you a little bit with truth. But can I tell you something today? He's not going to compromise and make you feel good with a lie today. Okay? Truth's truth. Matter of fact, Jesus said in John 17, "Sanctify them through thy truth. Thy word is truth today." Amen? Appreciate those songs today. And I tell you, time to get Emily back up here. They're going to have a quartet. Good job, Kirsten. Amen. And appreciate you being here today. Let's all stand, and if our ushers will come. And Sister Wanda, if you'll get yourself in place while they're coming. Let me say this today. Christmas play practice still at 3 o'clock up till 5 today. Next Sunday night, boy, the time's going on by us so quickly. Next Sunday night will be our annual Christmas play here at the church. And then, of course, that'll start at our normal 6 o'clock time next Sunday night. So keep that in mind. And then on Tuesday night, on the 19th, we'll be having our Christian school Christmas play here. And that'll be at 7 o'clock on Tuesday night. So you got a chance to get in two good Christmas plays here at the church in the next week or so. Whichever prayer team is lined up for prayer this evening, continue to do that. But I do want to encourage you, if you can, maybe to move the prayer team meeting tonight over to the small fellowship building. The Butcher family needs to be here about 5 o'clock to set up for the singing tonight. So prayer team, whichever prayer team's down for tonight, if y'all would just meet over there, I think it would be a little bit quieter for you with the prayer group tonight here at the church. But let's ask the Lord to bless this offering today. Appreciate everyone that gives around here each week for the ministry. And appreciate those of you that sometimes you're not able to give, but you're here and you serve the Lord and you want to be part of this ministry. We appreciate everything that goes on around here on the property every day. Okay, Brother Todd, you have something? After church, are those still back here? Okay, if a couple of you guys could jump in on that and help grab those out of the shelter back here behind the church, it would be greatly appreciated. But let's ask the Lord's blessing over the offering. After we pray, you can be seated, and Sister Wanda will sing for us today, okay? But Brother Ray Farmer, would you pray for us?
Thank you, Lord, for letting us be in your house today, Lord.
Yes. Amen. Yes. Amen. All right, you can be seated.
I thank the Lord for saving me and for all his many blessings and just for being so good. good to us, and
Amen.
Like Judy said, I'm thankful just to get to be here, to get to go to church, and I thank him for my church and my church family and for all of you, and you just listen to the words of this song. Shepherds came to worship him, wise men came from afar, but the light that they were seeking was more than just a star. He was heaven's gift sent down to earth, Mary's little boy, wrapped there in swaddling clothes. Was peace, love, and joy. There's never been a greater gift. God gave his only Son, through whom extended mercy and grace to everyone. The reason why this king would come, be born within a stall, was to die for me on Calvary, the greatest Christmas tree of all. From a stable in Bethlehem to a cross upon a hill, praying, soldiers that nailed him there, no beauty could they see, yet an ornament of love they were hanging on that tree. No ribbons, no angel tops, just a thorny crown, and his gift to all the world was his blood flowing down. From a stable in Bethlehem to a cross upon a hill, praying, Father, please not my will, but thine to fulfill. From the safety
Thank God he's the light of the world today. Amen. I'm thankful today for salvation that's only through the Lord Jesus Christ. And I'm thankful today for this Christmas season. But I don't want to get so caught up in the materialistic side of Christmas that I miss the most important reason why we celebrate this time of year. And I want to try to encourage you through the Word of God today and next Sunday, and then, of course, on Christmas Eve, that Sunday morning, with sermons from the Word of God that should help us to appreciate where the real gifts are and the importance of those gifts. Sometimes we get something handed to us and we say, this is a gift to you. And we appreciate that gift for a short period of time. But when God hands you a spiritual gift, that gift is to not only be appreciated right then and there, but that gift is to be with you the rest of your life. Last week we looked at the gift of light. This morning I want to take a look in the Word of God at the gift of life. Take your Bibles and turn with me to 1 John chapter number 1. Appreciate you men coming down and those that prayed on the pew with Brother Todd a moment ago. I'm glad God still got this, Todd. Amen. Notice with me in the Word of God together. If you brought your Bible this morning, say amen. Amen. It's nothing like the eternal Word of God. It's nothing like having the Holy Spirit of God inside of you to teach you the Word of God. I can teach it, but if your spirit and my spirit doesn't match up together with the Word of God, you're not going to learn a whole lot. The Bible says the natural man receiveth not the things of the Spirit of God. If you're not saved today, I'm glad you're here. But you will not understand spiritual things from the truth of the Bible until the Spirit of God comes to dwell inside of you. But if you're not careful, even if the Spirit of God's inside of you, we can grieve the Spirit. We can quench the Spirit, the Bible says. Notice what he says here, 1 John chapter number 1. I want to read the first four verses. I may have said this here before. You say it often at my previous church. The Gospel of John is there to teach you how to be saved. It presents the gospel of the death, burial, the resurrection of Christ. The Lord used the same human penman in John to pin down what we have now in 1 John and 2 John and 3 John and then last of all the book of Revelation. It's here in 1 John that God says you now that you're a believer, that you're a follower of Christ. Here's now how I see you, that you're one of my children. Not how your neighbor sees you. Not how your family sees you. Not how sometimes you see yourself. That's why he tells us in the same book of 1 John, there's days that your heart will condemn you. He said, but I'm here to remind you, I'm still greater than your heart. Aren't you glad for that today? There's days that our feelings, our emotions get in the way. Our old nature gets in the way. And there's days that we just go around and we condemn our own self. But the Bible says God's still greater than your heart. And as you get to 1 John chapter 1, when I first got saved and many years after reading these verses, it never really came alive to me in these verses until a few years ago. I want you to look what he says, because here we find the gift of life. He said, that which was from the beginning, going back to John 1:1 from last week, and he said, which we, I want you to mark the little word, circle the little word we, because it jumps off the page at us here in these first few verses. He said, which we have heard, which we have seen with our eyes, which we have looked upon, and our hands have handled of the word of life. For this life was manifested, he said, it was revealed. And we, he says, have seen it and bear witness and show unto you that eternal life which was with the Father and was manifested unto us. And then he says again, that which we have seen and heard, declare we unto you, that ye also may have fellowship with us. And truly, our fellowship is with the Father and with his Son, Jesus Christ. And these things write we unto you, he said. Notice now, he said, I'm telling you all of these things so that you might leave this church today and know what it is to live a life of joy. Not just at Christmas time, Not just when the family's packing the car up for a week of vacation, but you can have joy in the hard times, in the difficult times, the times where it seems you can't find a friend, the times when it seems your health is failing. He said you can have joy. Amen? The Word of Life is one of the most amazing titles that was given in the Word of God to the Lord Jesus Christ. The Word of Life. Let that set in. The Word of Life. See, the purpose behind the powerful Word of God is to reveal, watch, the Word of Life to each of us. We find that clearly stated. Flip in your Bible over a few pages from where we're at to 1 John 5:13. I want you to see these truths with us this morning. We find that purpose clearly in the Word of God itself here in 1 John 5:13. Notice what the Bible teaches here. He said, "These things have I written unto you that believe on the name of the Son of God, that you may know that you have eternal life, and that you may believe on the name of the Son of God." So, look, the Bible tells us that each of us that are alive today and those that lived before us, we all have eternal existence. We have conscious, eternal existence about us. But listen, I'm going to go further than that. John is saying there's a group of people that will have not only eternal existence, but those people will also have eternal life. Now, we're talking about the gift of life today. See, most people this time of year think they're living the life. I'm going to find me a party to go to. I'm going to find this to get caught up in. And they get caught up in so many things that they think is living. As the Lord opens for the first epistle of John, we find how quickly he leads us to the Word of Life. Your Bible says in John 1:1, "In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. The same was in the beginning with God." That verse takes us back further than even Genesis 1:1. Genesis 1:1 says, "In the beginning, God created the heaven and the earth." Think about that. In the beginning. You realize just in a few little words in Genesis 1:1 is enough to make every man, woman, boy, girl guilty before God. They can deny the Bible. They can deny the existence of the Bible. But in the beginning, God, the Bible says. John 1:1 takes us to a state in the beginning. And God already exists. Folks, God had no beginning. And God has no end. God has no middle. See, the Bible says in Psalm 90, I did a funeral service on Friday. I thought something was around my neck. Thought it was a snake there for a minute. I did have a spider a while ago. I went back in the back room back there. I wasn't trying to come out and be like some famous TV preacher. Just had a spider on my jacket, and I didn't want to panic up here in front of all y'all. Amen. Thank God Kirsten over here saved a preacher's life today. I'm trying to be calm and cool, and she's a preacher. "There's a spider on you." I said, "Okay, I'm going to ease back here in the back and see if I can't find it." But look, the Bible says in Psalm 90 that we spend our years as a tale that's told. All of us have a time period over here where life begins. But over here we have a time period where life down here ends. But listen to me, all of us will eternally exist. But some of us will have eternal life. You see the difference there? And John is telling us these things, but in the same time, he's telling you God has always existed. God has always been eternal. God has not had a beginning. God has not had a middle. And God will never have an end. Amen? He's eternal. God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Spirit, all three are co-equal, co-existent, eternally existent, he says. While at the same time, God the Son became a man without ever ceasing to be God. That's important at Christmas time to know. It goes beyond the babe in the manger. It goes beyond some angels declaring glory to God in the highest, peace on earth and goodwill toward men. It goes beyond some shepherds. It goes beyond a manger. That little babe that was laying in that manger wrapped in swaddling clothes was the eternal God of heaven. Amen? He became a man without ever ceasing to be God. Amen? He's coexistent, co-eternal with God the Father and God the Holy Spirit. He came to this earth robed in flesh. He is the incarnate God. Take your Bible, John chapter 1, look at verse 14. I'm not making this stuff up. I've been preaching long enough now. I've come too far to make this stuff up. There's too much Bible here for me not to find something to preach. Look what your Bible says in John 1:14. The Bible said in the Word. John 1:1, in the beginning, he's the Word. Scripture said John 1:14. Look, John 3:16 is the most beautiful verse of Scripture in all the Bible. But John 1:14, in my opinion, is a verse, all of it's good, but John 1:14 is one of those verses you just can't leave alone. And he says in verse 14, and the Word was made flesh and dwelt among us, and we beheld his glory. The glory is of the only begotten of the Father, full of grace and truth. And the Word, he said, was made flesh. When we think of the Word of life this morning, you have to remember, don't forget this, that God Almighty became man without ever ceasing to be God at the same time. The Word, Jesus Christ, never laid aside his deity. He just laid aside his glory. And Peter and James and John got to see a little taste of what that glory was on the Mount of Transfiguration. So when he left heaven, he never laid aside the fact that he was God. He just laid aside the glory that one day we'll see again, praise God, when we get to heaven someday. It was veiled in flesh as he was robed in flesh, and he came, the Bible said, to dwell among us. Why, preacher, why did he do that? Whoo! That he might go to Calvary 2,000 years ago and bleed and die for the sins of all mankind. Your sins and my sins and your neighbor's sins and Adolf Hitler's sins and the sins of the Clintons and the sins of the Trumps and the sins of every boy, girl, man, and woman that'll ever be born. And the Bible said he was buried in a borrowed tomb. And praise the Lord, he got up on the third day. Nancy, if he didn't get up on the third day, you won't get up. Your loved ones that have been buried, they'll never get out of the grave if he didn't get up first. Hey, man, but I've got good news for you here. A couple weeks before Christmas, he got up. He got up. And he's alive forevermore. That's one of the best gifts you can receive. This Christmas is the gift of life. We all get gifts that sometimes we will thank you so much. And you get in the car and chunk it back there behind the second seat. It makes early yard sale in the spring. Thank you. That is so great. Look at me. We all get those gifts. We all sometimes hand them out, don't we? Even ordering it online. But the moment you get the gift of life, that's one that'll never wear out. That's one that if you truly ever get it, you'll have your highs and lows, your ups and downs. But that's a gift that won't wear out, and it's a gift that you'll be grateful for. It's a gift you'll be thankful for to the day he calls you out of this life. The free gift of life. Look at number one with me. Number one, I want you to see the revealed word of life. The revealed word of life. Let's go back to 1 John chapter 1. Dissect these four verses here for just a moment with me. Bible says in verse number 1 and verse number 2, here's some things that's worth noting here. Now, understand something here. John, the Apostle John, the beloved John, is the human penman of this book. Now, let's understand a little bit about John. Some of you knew it, Christianity. Some of you have been around this a long time. But John grew up in a little area, a little region called Bethsaida, which was near another region called Capernaum, by the way. And Capernaum was an area that Jesus settled down in, and Jesus performed more miracles and done more great works for the city of Capernaum than anywhere else in his earthly journeys. And John grew up around that. And he and his brother James, they were fishermen by trade. And those two brothers were among some of the first people that Jesus called to follow him in his earthly ministry. Now picture the setting here. By the time John gets to pin this down, he's testifying to a third generation of believers. Three generations have come and gone. Whoo! Since John saw the things that he's writing to this generation of Christians. Those people needed a fresh touch from God by the time John writes this down. Can I tell you something? We need a fresh touch from God today. You're in a great church today. I said you're in a great church today. This church has had a good history. We're not looking to change that. This church has had the right Bible from day one. Not looking to change that. You're blessed. There are churches everywhere you turn that are closing the doors. You know why? Because they never grasped a hold of these truths, or they got away from these truths. But even in a great church like you're in today, some days you just need a fresh touch. And this generation of believers did. And he's saying here in these verses that Jesus Christ In the Word, God showed up. John is saying that Jesus Christ, your search, if you're looking for Jesus, your search is over, he said. He said he's manifested himself. He's revealed himself as the God of heaven. Look at verse 1. Look again at the verse. He said, that which was from the beginning, which we have heard, which we have seen with our eyes, which we've looked upon. He said, our very hands have handled of the word of life. John said, folks, listen to me. He said, I know you're a third generation of believers. He said, you never saw what I got to see. He said, but listen to me. I want you to know I was there. Whoo! He said, I heard him speak with his voice. The same voice that spoke your universe into existence. Whew, Brother Benny. He said the very voice that hung the sun, the moon, the stars, the planets, the very voice that created man from the dust of the earth. He said, we were there. He said, I heard it. He said, I heard it with my own ears. He said, I saw it with my very eyes. What have you been seeing lately? What's your eyes look at every week? If Jesus walked in here, robed in flesh, set aside his glory, Is what your eyes been seeing all week, would it line up with what John saw? Hello, help me out now. John said, with these old eyes I have, I saw him. I beheld him. Look at verse 1 again. He said, which we have looked upon. That, look, that goes beyond just a casual look. Whew. I'm glad three of you is getting it with me. Look here. That goes beyond a casual look. Yesterday, walking in the parade, there's all types of things going on around you and everywhere you turn, and some things you just have to take a casual look at. But every time I looked at our old float there pulling behind that trailer, and that float had that box up on back of that trailer, woo! And boy, every time I'd look up there, Brother Benny, I'm in the third heaven right now. Some of y'all still in Hardee's. Look at me now. And every time I'd look up and see that little manger, the Spirit of God would show me in my spirit and bear witness, Brother Greg, in my spirit, what Jesus means to me. He's the greatest gift the world's ever had. And John said, I saw him. I heard him. My eyes saw him. He said, but I went beyond seeing him. He said, I went beyond just a casual look. Yeah. He said, I examined him because I never heard another man speak like he spoke. Said, I never saw another man touch another man's eyes that were blind from birth and open them up. He said, I never saw another man open up deaf ears. He said, I never saw a man get healed from leprosy just instantaneously. He said, I even see him head out to a little village called Nain, and he said there was a widow woman there. Her husband's gone, and her only boy's laid out in a little coffin. Man, I'm about to swing through here like Tarzan here. He said, and I walked by, and that lifeless man that was in that casket, he said, I saw him stop the funeral procession. And I saw him reach in there. I watched that young man set up in that casket. He said, I watched him crawl out and go back home with his mama. He said, I went beyond a casual look. Look at me. This Christmas season, somebody in this room, you're just going to take a casual look, but you better get your eyes beyond the casual look and get the free gift of life that Jesus Christ is leaving for you today. I'm glad there was a time in my life that I went beyond a casual look, that I went beyond, well, I'll go to church at Christmas time. I'll go at Easter time. I'll go on homecoming Sunday. Those are casual looks. No, I took a strong look. Because thank God I got to the point, Brother Benny. Well, I was tired of me. I was tired of who I was. I was tired of the life I was living. I was tired of laying down at night with no peace in my soul. Woo! I was tired of that. And I said, I got to take a better look than what I've been looking at. John said, we went beyond casual looking. He said, he asked me to follow him. And I did. Yeah. Whew. He said, but when I got plugged in, I didn't realize how good it was going to be. Right. Yeah. Whoo! He didn't say, he said, I didn't realize how good it was in the beginning. He said, I saw that public ministry. Let me remind you, he said, I saw the opening of the blinded eyes, the deaf ears. He said, I saw the demons cast out. He said, I saw him take a little boy's lunch one day out on a hillside and feed 5,000 men besides the women and children on a few hush puppies and sardines that a boy brought for lunch. He said, I saw that. He said, I saw him touch a lame man, a crippled man. He said, I remember one day we was down at the temple. Hallelujah. I'm about to flip that piano. Look here now. He said, I saw a woman bent over. Everybody had cast her to the side. But Toddy said, all she could do was look down at the ground. Been that way for 18 plus years. Whew. He said, but the one that I ran with, he said, he touched that lady that night down at the synagogue, and she just all of a sudden, she looked everybody in the eye. He said, I saw that. He said, I saw him raise the dead. But look at me. John said, I saw the same man take a Roman cross on his back, beat beyond recognition. He said, same guy that I saw be good to everybody and touch blinded eyes and deaf ears and raise the dead. He said, I saw the same guy take a Roman cross and put it on his back and take it up the hillside to Golgotha. And I saw the same guy look up to the Father and say, Father, forgive them. For they know not what they do. He said, I saw him a few hours later take his lifeless body, put it in a barred tomb. He said, I'm telling you, fellas, 3 days later. He said, I'm telling you, I was a witness to the glorious resurrection. John said, I know it's all real. I've examined it all. And he said, I'm telling you, look at me. Look, 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 look. Jesus is everything he claims to be. He said, I'm trying to tell you, he's God. He's eternal God manifest in the flesh. He said, my hands handled him. Do you know what that's saying? He said, I know what it is to reach out and actually touch and feel the warmth of the body of God in the flesh. Look at verse 2. He said, for this life was manifested. That means revealed. And we've seen it and bear witness and show unto you that eternal life which was with the Father and which was manifested. He said unto us, John said Jesus existed before he ever came to this earth. He was with the Father in the Spirit and was manifested and revealed to us. And folk, everything that Christmas is about and the Christian life is about comes out of those verses. What I'm trying to say to all of us, our faith is to make a difference in our lives. You just heard from a man that said what I had made a difference in my life. Amen? See, if all we do is talk about the facts of Christmas and Christians and Jesus, then we've missed it. Do you hear me? If all you do is talk about the facts about Jesus, you have missed it. John said it's real. I've seen him. I've handled him. I've beheld him. My ears heard him. See, a lot of us, we've gotten good at giving answers to people at Christmas and other times. to satisfy ourselves, to satisfy them with words that sound good about Jesus. But do we truly know what John is even speaking here? Amen? Folk, I'm trying to tell you, he's real. He's revealed. He's the eternal Son of God. And he's the gift of life this Christmas. Now, let me ask you a question here. Has he truly changed your life? I'm afraid some of us just know the facts about him. It's not just this church, it's every church. There's a lot of people that know the facts about Jesus. We got a little head knowledge of Jesus. But look at me. Can you talk about him this week the way John talked about him? If you can't, then I doubt very seriously you ever changed your life. When he does, you won't want the things of the world. When he does, you won't want the music of the world. When he does, you won't want the immorality of the world. You won't want the religions of the world. You won't want the drugs of the world and the alcohol of the world and the living it up kind of world that we have all around us. Why, preacher? Because he will make a difference. And you won't have to get excited about him in the energy of the flesh. You know why? Because you know he's within you. And you know, according to 2 Corinthians 5:17, therefore, if any man be in Christ, he's a new creature. Oh, look, hey, old things are passed away. Behold, all things become new. The revealed word of life. Quickly, John said, there's the declared word of life. Look at verse 3. He said, that which we have seen and heard, look at the next word, declare we unto you. Do you realize we can't know about Jesus without declaring him? Without proclaiming him? Without speaking about him? That which we have seen and heard, declare we unto you. See, that message was first declared by the angels. Out on the outskirts of Bethlehem. Then by the shepherds. And then 2 years later by the wise men. And look here, I'm going somewhere with this. But they didn't understand the angels even and the shepherds and the wise men. They didn't understand everything about the death, burial, and the resurrection like John did. And he said in verse 3, we have to talk about it. We have to speak about it. Are y'all listening? When you love somebody, you're going to speak about them. You love your wife, fella? Appreciate a couple of you guys about that. Yeah. When you love her, you'll speak about her. Nobody will have to tell you, hey, go get her a card. You just tell her. Yeah. Ladies, you love your husband. Do you tell people you love him? You love your kids? Hey, kids, you love your daddy, your mama? See, when you love somebody, you tell somebody about them. See, we're not talking about Jesus and speaking about Jesus because it's something wrong with the knowledge we have of him. People got ideas about him. They got facts about him. They got nice little answers about him just to keep you off their back. But it's all meaningless. Look at your Bible quickly. I'm just about finished. Look at 1 John chapter 2. Look at verse 6. Remember, 1 John's written to the believer. It's written to those that say, I know him, I'm saved, I'm born again. You don't have to ride me about it. Look what he says. 1 John chapter 2, look what he says in verse 6. He that saith, he abideth in him. I belong to him. I'm with him. The Bible said, ought himself also to walk, notice, even as he walked. Folk, if we truly got the gift of life, we don't mind sharing it with people at work, at the mall, at Walmart, at school, in the Christmas parade, at the post office. Why wouldn't we hand out a gospel tract? Why wouldn't we arrange for a Bible study? 1 John 1, 3 said that ye also may have fellowship with us. We won't turn there because I got to finish the message, but make you a note, Acts chapter number 4, people were being threatened, they were being beaten, they were being persecuted and told not to speak of Jesus Christ again. Some of them, it was going to cost them their lives, Brother Mike. Verse 19 of that chapter, a man got healed. He got made whole. Watch me now. And people got mad. Why would you get mad because a man got healed? Huh? Verse 20, they said, we just got to talk about him. We can't do it. Look, all we do is what we saw, the disciples said. What we know, what we have. Look here, friend. This Christmas, if you truly know him, it's impossible not to talk about him. You hear me? We sing a little song here in the chapel sometimes on Fridays. Let's talk about Jesus. The King of Kings is he, the Lord of Lords supreme throughout eternity. The great I am, the way, the truth, the life, the door. Let's talk about Jesus more and more. John said, when you know him, when you've seen him, you've heard him, you've handled him, when he's made himself known to you, you'll declare him. Now look here today as we stand over the building. Brother Jay, if you make your way down here today. John said there was the manifested word of life. He said it was revealed. He said we saw it, we heard it, we beheld it, we've touched it. He said there's the declared word of life. Look at me now. But in verse 4, he said there was the possessed word of life. You see, when you've got the word of life in your possession, he said, these things write we unto you. He said, I want you to have joy in your life. Some of you don't have any joy today. And I'm convinced the reason you don't is because you've never received the gift of life. You can receive it this morning. Piano's playing, that won't save you. But if you'll meet Jesus down this aisle, he'll save you. He'll give you life. He'll give you life worth meaning. He'll give you life worth living. Do you have that life? If you don't, find somebody and say, I need that. I need that life the preacher's preaching. That's right. Let's mind the Lord today. I didn't ask if you were a visitor. I didn't ask if you was a church member, deacon, usher, Sunday school teacher. I'm just asking you, do you have the real word of life in you? If you don't, would you come and receive it today? If God has spoken to you, if God has convicted you, then step out. Don't keep putting it off. Bible said it's appointed unto me and wants to die. And after this, the judgment. When you've got the word of life in your possession, you have him, and you have him in common with other people. And that way you can have fellowship with people at this church and people outside this church that have that same life within them. That's the beauty of Christianity. I can fellowship better with people in this church than I can sometimes my own relatives. You know why? Because we have something in common. Some of y'all have been around each other for years here at this church. I hadn't been around some of y'all for about 14 months, but I've been able to develop a friendship. Why has it been so easy? Because of the fellowship of the life that we have. You say, well, I don't have that. Then you might not have the life I've been preaching this morning. 1 Corinthians 6:9 gives you a bad list of a lot of bad people. Matter of fact, the kind of people that you would probably suspect to be on a neighborhood watch. The kind of people you wouldn't want around your kids. The kind of people you wouldn't want around your grandkids. But I'm going to tell you something. Verse number 11 said, and such were some of you. But now you've been washed. In other words, you've received the word of life. All of us were bad people. All have sinned and come short of the glory of God. Wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord. All of us are born bad. Some of us just get a little more bad. But the Bible said such were some of you. But you know what? 2 Corinthians 4:7 said you received the Spirit of God. That's a treasure inside of you. It's a gift. You say, what is the gift? It's none other than the Lord Himself. Do you have that gift? Do you have that treasure in your earthen vessel? If it's there, you'll know it. You'll know it. You won't have to convince mama or daddy or your spouse or the preacher. It's just there. I don't look anybody in this eye. Rather, I'm standing up here and I try to look y'all in the eye. Sometimes when I get to look in some of you in the eye, you think I'm praying and you start looking down. But I'm looking you in the eye. I know that I know it's well with my soul. 30 years ago, last August, I got the gift of light and I got the gift of life. And because I have that, it's hard for me to shut up about it. You don't have to be the pastor. You just got to have the light and the life. And when you got that gift, you want somebody else to have it. I don't want to ever think that, I don't want you to think I'm mean-spirited. I just preach with passion. I preach what I believe to be true according to this book. I'm not up here to give you fairy tales and short stories. Every now and then I'll tell you a joke, but I really get up here and just tell you the truth. We need it. Somebody told you truth a long time ago if you're truly saved, and they loved you enough to tell you. Maybe in the beginning your feelings got hurt. Maybe in the beginning you got mad at it. But somewhere along the line, your conscience and the Holy Spirit began to work together. And you saw yourself in the condition you're in. And you just received that gift. Hey, it's better than any new phone this Christmas. It's better than any perfume, ladies. Hey, ladies, I'd rather you stink all year. But you smell good in Jesus. Let that one set in the car. Amen? Yeah. $100 bottle of perfume or higher ain't going to help you when you meet Jesus one day. I'd rather go to heaven stinking, but get there smelling good. That'll preach. I'm going to take note on that and preach that one Sunday. Some of you now looking at me, it's time to go on. Hey, look here. That gift of life, it's there. John said, we saw it. We heard it. He said, I examined it a little better. He said, I even touched it. He said, it's real. Amen? You ever get it, and you really get it, it gets real in your life. Amen? Thank you for playing, Brother Jay. If you're not saved today, you're doubting it, you're struggling, man, stick around. It's raining outside. I'd rather you leave here with the sun shining in your heart today. Amen? Well, praise the Lord. Amen. Woo! Amen. Hallelujah. How about that? How about that? Amen. Look here. I'm convinced every church in America's got it. I wasn't born last night. I've been doing this pretty good while. The Lord allows a preacher, a pastor, to have a discerning spirit about things. And I'm telling you, look at me. It's not just Emily in this room. I was sitting in Westside Baptist Church years ago before the tornado came through. I was a young Christian sitting in that revival service one night. Brother Nathan, I was sitting in that church as a young Christian, and Dr. Sammy Allen came in to preach that night. Say what you want. He was a Bible preacher. That man could quote more Bible verses than any preacher I ever met in my life. You either liked him or you didn't. But I sat in Westside Baptist Church one night, choir sung one song, got ready to sing another one, and got just barely going in that song. And Sammy Allen said, Brother Paul, he said, I hope I'm not out of line here. He said, but you got people in your choir that are lost. And everybody went and sat down. And the Word of God was preached, and the Holy Spirit of God dealt with those people's hearts. And one of the ones that got saved was Brother Paul's own son. I was there. I was like, John, I saw it. These 10, 11 church members got saved. Do you have that? Do you have what I preached? Can you look me in the eye out there in the foyer on the front porch and say, I got that. It's real to me. If you don't, man, quit playing with your soul. Quit gambling your soul. You're going to die. My uncle Jimmy Barnes died last Saturday. I did that funeral Friday. He's 81 years old. I told the people in the funeral home when I was a boy, I was scared of him. I had reason to be. When I was a teenager, I was scared of my uncle. Look at me. But when my grandma died in the kitchen and he saw it, she dropped dead. But when she hit the floor, she was already in heaven. Why? Because she had life. And a couple days later, he had a heart attack. They took him out to Forsyth Hospital. This is 1999. And the man that I was scared of all my life. Brother Ricky, the Holy Spirit of God said, you need to go to that hospital and tell him about Jesus. And I went. And I went in the room and I sat down and I said, Jimmy, look at me. If that had been you that dropped dead in the kitchen floor Sunday night, where would you be? Hey, he wasn't going to shoot me in the hospital. And B, he wasn't going nowhere. Now, we might have had to dealt with it outside the hospital, but when the Spirit of God gets on you to witness, you better witness. And I told him truth. I went around him a lot after that. They moved. But based on the decision he made, I have to say, if he meant business with God that night, he's in heaven. But only eternity will reveal it. Can I tell you this, and we're going to pray? You don't always get these kind of services. Though I preach truth, I knew when I walked in this pulpit today, somebody in this room needed beyond this. Look me. Look. But I can look you in the eye and tell you, if my life ends today, it's well with my soul. Thank God for cards and gifts and money. We all like those things. But the best gifts are what I'm preaching. Amen? Thank you for minding the Holy Spirit today and getting saved. Yes, ma'am, I want you to. I'd be good.
Thank God for saving me today.
Amen. Yep. Yeah. Yep. How about that? Amen. 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 I led my wife to the Lord in the bedroom, and she sung songs and testified just like everybody else, but it never was real. If Jesus can walk around with 12 men, and one of them was the devil, and that same man had the same powers to touch and heal during the earthly ministry of Jesus, don't you think in a Baptist church where there's wheat, there's also tares that look like the wheat? And one of these days when we get to heaven, that's when the real separation will come. You're either going to be a tare or a wheat. Nice suit won't get you to heaven. Nice dress won't get you to heaven. It's got that gift of life is what gets you there. Amen. Thank you for that testimony today. Yes, sir. Yeah. Amen.
But I'd like to say this. You preached all that, and I'm sitting here, and it's just like I'm already saved. The Lord said, that was you. I was lost, and the devil, I tried to do good on my own.
Right. Sure.
And then Christmas don't come but once a year. If I get drunk, no one's here. Let me tell you something. I'm going to take this message to heart because God will always give you the chance.
That's right. Sure. That's right.
But you might leave here, but you might not make it back.
Yep. Sure.
Well, he said this and he said that. I don't play games. Don't tell me what somebody else said, this and that. Glad that you cost somebody the life that shouldn't be in the game and got killed. I can say, well, Brother Scott has said this and Brother Scott's going to do that. Then I can add him on to do
that. Sure. Sure.
And the other guy weighed about 300. Well, I'm going to whoop you. He said, you ain't going to whoop me. And the other guy told me, he won't do nothing. He won't do nothing. But see, I knew. I know a little bit about Scott. I thought, well, this ain't going to come out of you. So enough, he killed.
Yeah, yeah. That's right. That's right.
Now he's got to live with another guy that's going to determine if he was younger than all. But see, God, let me see that for a reason. It always comes back. Always comes back. It could have been me. It could be you. But where are you going to spend eternity at?
Yep. Yep.
Years ago.
That's right. Yep. Amen.
What I know about you, you live what you preach.
Amen.
You and your family, you live what you preach. And why waste your time?
That's right.
TV preachers and all, when you can come right down.
Amen.
And stop here and hear a good message. Get saved. Get right.
Amen.
Don't go out into eternity lost.
Amen.
Don't leave this building today lost. Please.
Amen. Sure. Amen. 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 Appreciate the testimony. Hey, look here. Ladies especially, Miss Emily, would you come by here? Emily needs your prayers. Hey, I'm glad she made the right choice today and got saved. You, look, don't you throw her under the bus. Don't you throw rocks at her and say, well, I thought she was saved. Look here. You might be the other one that we think are saved. I'd rather somebody drop their pride and say, look, I'm coming to the cross. Look here. I commend her. I really do. I commend her for what she did today. Ladies especially, come by and hug her neck. Let her know you love her. Hey, fellas, let her know you're glad she got saved today. Amen. Nothing wrong with what she did today. She got it settled. Amen. God bless you. Hey, service, we're going to pray tonight. Service, 6 o'clock. Butcher family will be here singing. Brother Jesse will be preaching. Prayer group, keep in mind, go over to the fellowship building at 5. Men, while you come down here and thank her for getting saved, if you plan to go eat Christmas supper with us on Tuesday, we're leaving out of here at 5:15 on the bus. If you're not riding the bus, meet us at Coronet Seafood at 6 o'clock. Want you to come after that. If your stomach can hold it, we'll go to the Dario and get some ice cream. Amen. All right, let's pray and be dismissed at this time. Daniel, if you would, how about you praying for us?